This session, I have great members of the U-coHub team with me again. A few minutes to introduce them quickly. I have with me on set, I believe, Mr. Soji Megbowon, who is the team lead of the U-coHub project team. I also have Mr. Adewale Paul. Please, I'm running through the names quickly to save time. So I also have Ms. Wonuola Omotosho, Mr. Ajayi David. I also have Mr. Emmanuel Tobiloba and Ms. Sheila Daniels. And of course, I am your anchor, Ms. Amide, and we will be helping enjoy this session by sharing all that you need to know. So sit back, relax. And enjoy every part of it. As pads, be ready to take down every information being given, because you know, information comes like rain, little by little, every day in every session. And then before you know it, you are ready for the big stage. So don't be distracted. Point. Don't all those things that you have to do for it, because trust me, you're going to have enough time to do them. So round to the opening mark. So can anyone hear me, please? Miss Wonola, are you there?
Yeah, good evening.
Thank you. Good evening. So we are waiting for your opening remark now. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Good job there. Yeah, it's so good to be here again this week. People leaving. Can we all hear me?
Yes, you can.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. So once again, beautiful evening to all amazing leaders on this platform tonight, dear mentees, beloved mentors, organizers of this weekly session, and of course, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for joining this week's virtual mentorship session on grant writing, the myth as regards grant writing, the mouth-watering parties, how to write a winning grant proposal. Believe me, this is a part everyone should pay due to. Because your idea at one point in time is a perfect proposal to launch your idea. So I'm going to be sharing briefly two myths that has held me back or that is holding me back. Firstly, you know, I believe only prestigious institutions get all the money and no one else has a chance. A starter like me, so I feel that I might not get a grant, so I feel my proposal might not be worked on. Why? Because my institution or my organization is not a prestigious one, or even if I write this particular grant where we have thousands of, you know, prestigious organizations, companies with names, and that's me, that should not hold you back. And secondly, I have always believed, or I held on to the fact that writing a proposal is hard. So most times when you tell no one allowed for your organization, write this, I'm always like it's a big thing, like it's a hard thing. So just here tonight, I am going to be grabbing my notepad and pen as I learn and as we all learn at the feet of our trainers, Master Tobiloba and Master Jai David tonight. So have an amazing session. Please feel free to drop your questions in the box as we all enjoy the session tonight. Thank you. My name is Wola.
Wow, thank you so much. Thank you so much for that beautiful opening remark, Miss Wonla. Thank you once again. Now I'm going to be handing you over to my co-anchor, Miss Sheila. Miss Sheila is going to be doing a giveaway session quickly before we get to the main session of today's event, you know, just to energize you, you know, get you excited a bit. So, Miss Sheila, if you can hear me, can you take over the microphone? Yes, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
So we have let's take this is getting the session. We're starting with flow. We have flow 1 6. Then I'll be moving quickly to MTN 2 3 7 1 2 1 3 9 4 7 8 9 4. That would be all for this quick session. To share the link across our status, across our
okay, so I want to be sure that Sheila, who is talking, please, is Sheila network having problem, please? Madam, please confirm. Please confirm you can hear me, everyone.
Miss Sheila, are you there?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, so I think that Ms. Sheila is having a bit of a network problem. So we would go back to the giveaway session after the main session. That would be before the Q&A. So we'd move that to the rest of the giveaway to that time. About now, we're going to be calling up Mr. Emmanuel Tobloba for the main session where we get to learn about grant writing, the meets, and how to write a winning grant proposal. So join me to make welcome Mr. Emmanuel Tobiloba as he takes over the mic.
All right, thank you so much. Good evening, everyone. Again, I find it a privilege to be having a conversation with us again today. It's been an amazing week, and we must confess that we are making progress with learning and implementing those things. So right about now, it's going to be a very brief section where we'll talk about the need of grant and why you should write grants, and what are those things, or what are those written rules or laws of writing grants. During this section, sorry for the background noise, I'm actually on the screen. During section, Mr. Reed is going to project some of the questions for some grants that are ongoing that we are going to tackle together. While he's projecting that, we just have to have a discourse on what grant writing is. There are various ways you can raise money for your startup, right? There are various ways you can raise money for your startup. It's either you collect money or you collect funds. You collect fund from family, you collect fund from friends. That's one way. And the other way you can raise grant is through loan. However, being in business for some couple of years now, I found out that it is very risky, very, very risky to take loan to start up a business, especially a business you don't know the nitty-gritty. Even when you are sure you know the nitty-gritty. For example, the sector I play in, agricultural sector, you borrow loan in agricultural sector to probably do crop or animal farming. You are dancing on a brimstone, right? You are dancing on a brimstone because one, you are affected by climate change, and two, you know, a virus can trigger the death of as far as 10,000 breaths, like instantly. So you could borrow. Loan is not advisable when you're starting up, but advisable when you want to expand. Loan is advisable when you want to expand. So, and one of those ways, again, you can now raise money, whereby you don't have someone sitting on your neck telling you, when are you going to pay the interest rate, this, that, it's true grant writing. So, the sake of getting money to fund your business, for the sake of getting money to fund your business. So, why do you fund your business? Of course, the survival of your business is dependent on the cash flow. So, first, the first unwritten rule of grant writing, originality. You know, it is important that you are original, or you are being authentic while you are writing the grant application. You know, so people want to impress whoever is reviewing the grant application, then you want to just want to window dress. There's something in accounting called window dress. When you imagine number than necessary, for example, you are making 70,000, you make 70,000 as revenue in your first month. Because you want to impress whoever is reviewing the application, you will get it probably 370,000. Now, the problem would be much expectation will be required of you, and you might not be able to meet up with expectation. So, the first thing is originality. You need to be original. Two, which cannot be overemphasized, which we've talked about many times, is the ability to share the story that leads to whatever solution you are selling. Listen, guys, the impact of storytelling in the grant writing application cannot be overemphasized. Now, I read something very good, or something that would suit for anybody that feels it is boring repeating the same story year in, year out. There is a South African public speaker who said something. He said, for over 10 years now, there is a particular organization that keeps inviting him just to say that one thing they have said over 10 years. And what that thing is, just share stories on organizational culture. So imagine someone that is just saying the same story, telling the same thing, just to draw an analogy of organizational structure for 10 years, saying the same story. Your story can never go faint, right? So learn how you can push your business storytelling when you are writing a grant application. Then the third unwritten law is that you need to start early. Now, let me use a practical example. Last year, I put in for the Tony Melu Foundation and grant and competition. Well, I made it to the final stage, but one thing or the other, I was not selected. But it was a whole level of new experience. Now, one thing I learned was, for the delivery I had was, I started the application very early. So after starting the application very early, when I then out to mentors to help me review, I'm coming to that point. I sent out to mentors to help me review. When they reviewed, okay, you need to take away this figure, put this, put that, I skipped through. I was invited to make business pitch video, and that was the final lap. But one thing or the other, I didn't win 5,000 years in advance, but you know what? The experience was worthwhile and business training was worthwhile. What am I saying in essence? You need to master the act of starting your grant application early. So don't say because the application is going to close on the 31st of July and you start your application by July 29th. What that is going to do for you is going to pressure. There will be a lot of pressure on you. And when you are working under a huge pressure, you could omit things you need to put in your grant application. Another thing, which will be the last thing, will be projected for us to discuss some of the ongoing grants is the fact that you need to send your grant applications out for reviews. This cannot be overemphasized. While you are looking your grant from the place of perfection, that person is looking at it, oh, this person can do this in such a way that you could blend this and in such a way that give an absolute result, right? So you need to find, and one thing U-coHub is helping us do is there is no grant application we've sent a link that we don't offer or mentors are not available to review those applications. So you need to find someone to help you review application. The first point is that you need to master the art of storytelling in writing your grant. Two, you need to start early. This is very, very important. You need to find mentors to help you review. This is also important. So we're going to some of the few grant applications that are ongoing that we'll review together. So the next slide, Mr. David, thank you for the projection. Thank you so much. Okay, so you see this particular graph where you see creative industries. Now, many people do not know what the creative industries are or what the creative industry is. Now, the creative industry is that industry where most of the times you use your intellectual capacity to draw to bring solution to people's problem. So what are the example of creatives like writers and tech guys, digital marketers? These are creatives, right? So now this particular application we are going to be doing it now. They said because creative industry contributes. Yes, there's something called knowledge economy. Knowledge economy simply means an economy driven by knowledge, and this is one of the economy that helped Finland to scale through. This is one of the economy that helped Finland to scale through. I want to challenge everybody. There is a white paper online you need to read about Finland, how knowledge economy was important in their growth. So now,
Mr. Emmanuel, we
can't hear you
anymore.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So, Mr. David, can you please help me move the slide forward? All right, thank you. So, like I said, the creative industry has to do with, most of the times, the intellectual capacity and how creative you are. See, There is a level of creativity must exhibit, and creativity is what makes you scale in the business. So the first, like here you see design, you see leisure activities, you see 3D, you see, these are things that require intellectual capacity to be business like. So now let's just go to the questions. Thank you. Let's go to the questions. So here are the questions. Sorry, I just entered. Yeah, questions. So they said, give your high level pitch. What is your big story on your creative of service or that you are offering or product you are offering? Guys, listen, you see, they've made this so simple that, you know, literally some people would not even ask you what is the backup story or what is the back end story, but as it is, they've given you a clue that they just want to tell that story of how you if I'm in a fashion niche, if probably because I noticed that the African culture is not encouraged. The African culture where Africans no longer wear their own, Africans no longer derive pleasure in wearing African. And this could inspire me, probably because I traveled to, let's say, Rwanda, and I saw how the African culture is promoted. So I decided to, you know what, I'm going to be producing African wares for Africans alone, not only Africans alone, Africans in the diaspora. This could be my elevator pitch. This could be my big story of why I delve into fashion, why I delve into fashion. So what is going to be, the pattern is going to take first. Like I say, when you're writing, when you're presented with the opportunity to share a story of your brand, is first that you need to know the problem, first structure. Like I said during the storytelling class, you need to first talk about the problem. When you're talking about the problem, the next thing you need to talk about is the solution. Solving that problem. The problem of the solution is how you are solving that problem. Like I said, the Afrocentric example I gave. What is the Afrocentric example I gave of Africans or not encouraged or not motivated to wear our own styles? But because I saw this as probably something in later days, send African culture into an extinct. So I tried to take this off. That is the problem. Now the solution is, now I'm creating more wares for Africans so that they can appreciate their culture. So these are things I could be doing this through, you know, blog writings, through websites, through a lot of channels, right? So this, if I'm to answer this question, is the approach I just gave now. Then what type of service or product are you offering? Of course, let me keep using the fashion industry that I need. So I'm offering product of Afrocentric wares where Africans can readily wear fashion wares made by Africans and for Africans alone, right? So that, if I'm to describe the product I am offering. Then the next one is, what makes your creative idea or business offering unique? Wow, awesome. Now, this is where you're talking about your business unique selling point, your USP. Your business unique selling point. And what's your business unique selling point? Business unique selling point simply means what distinguishes you from others. What is that thing you are doing that others, this is very, what is that thing you're doing others are not doing? This is your business unique selling point. What you are doing others are not doing. So now, you are offering Afrocentric wares where Africans can wear theirs. And what makes this unique? Now, if I'm thinking like a fashion designer now, what makes my product or innovation unique is the fact that, not just that I it is rare for you to, you know, let's say for example, when I watched the documentary of Moremi of Ife, I saw kind of I'm infusing history in my Afrocentric wares. So that is my own unique selling point. So, you know, the whatever solution, whatever service you are rendering, there must be something so unique about your product that distinguishes it from others. Now, I read something about Amazon today. One thing that distinguishes Amazon from every other person is that they have this, what something we call customer-centric approach. They are focused on their customer. That means if Amazon sells you wrong product, what Amazon does is that they send you a new one you order and tell you to hold on to that wrong one they sold to you. That's how good Amazon can be. That is their own unique selling point. So what is your unique selling point? What makes you different? So I am thinking from the high end of a fashion designer, and I said it makes my own results unique in my own way of promoting African culture is the fact that I attach history to everywhere I make as a creative, right? So they said, please describe the specific problem that your product or service solves. The simple problem my product and the fashion entrepreneur is solving is that it is solving the problem of Africans not being aligned to their own world, to their own fashion brands. So I am solving the problem of whereby Africans can wear their own in order to promote the African culture, in order to promote the African culture. So I am solving the problem of helping the African culture not going into extinct by infusing history, by infusing history. So please, that is the specific. Now, they said specific. Yeah, you don't need to tell them a lot of things. I'm solving the problem of fashion, whereby Africans can wear their own in order to promote the African culture. As simple as that. For those of you that may, because U-coHub are giving a lot of people a spark, at the end of the day, you might end up as a medical consultant, whatever consultant, in something called specifics. So you need to attack every specific. So you don't need to be a lot of, you know, just be specific. So have you registered your product or services? When they ask you, have you registered, it means, is it registered with the Corporate Allied Corporate Affairs Commission? So you need to know if the Corporate Affairs Commission, that's CAC, if your business is registered. And it is important, now let me say this, right? That it is important for you to register your business. That is what makes people take you so seriously. That is what would make people take you serious. For example, you are writing a grant, you want me to fund your business, and you are expecting me to fund the business using your account. It doesn't work that way, right? It doesn't work that way. So when your business is registered, your product is registered, or your name is registered, then you can now open a bank account in the name of that business, right? In the name of that business. So the day you register your business, it shows that you are ready for real business, right? So you use a personal account for company's account. So if I'm to fund your business with, let's say, 15 million naira, and you're sending a personal account, however, you know, a lot of thoughts, probably this guy wants to eat the money or something. Or if you are sending an organizational account, I know that really aim for business. So you tell them, what customer segment are you targeting? Now, for example, let's still use the fashion industry I am using. Now, as a fashionpreneur who wants to promote the African culture, I might try to target Africans in the diaspora. When I mean Africans in the diaspora, it means guys in the US, guys in Brazil, you know, guys. And let me say this, that, you know, our language as it is, its originality is also, its origin can also trace it to Brazil. So I might say, okay, you know what, those Yorubas in Brazil, I want to be doing Yoruba wares, African wares, just for them alone, right? So those are my market segments. So I can say, market segment is Africans in the diaspora. And I might choose to say Africans, like when I'm Africans, Nigerians, or probably Nigerians in the diaspora. So that's so the next thing is how do you market your products? You need to be super creative here when they ask you how do you market your product. Now, for some of us we have in the storytelling class, I want to challenge us that you go back to the U-coHub channel to watch our section on storytelling. Now, how do you market your product? Now, there are various ways you can say you want to market your product through website. I would encourage that for those of us that are putting in this application, because it is that of communities. So I would say you should include social media as one of your marketing tools that you are going to put in for the application. Social media, you could use websites, yeah, like Instagram, Facebook, particularly, yeah, I'm
I'm talking from the standpoint of a fashionpreneur right now. I would use, if I'm to use anything as a fashionpreneur, I'll prefer Instagram and Facebook to market my product and website, right? So,
okay, so while we wait for,
can you hear me now?
Mr. Emmanuel, can we quickly have a quick giveaway session before you continue?
All right, it's fine. It's very, very fine.
So can you please signify in the chat if you can hear me, if you're here, because I'm about to do a quick giveaway session. Just type something in the chat, send an emoji, or unmute your mic. Thank you. So now I'm going to start with, I have Lo, so I'm going to start with Lo. Two nine one two one two two 316 1182. So please kindly signify in the chat if you got that, and I'm going to be moving on quickly to the next one. I have we have Etel 1304 304 6985 3246 2919. So please kindly signify in the chat if you got any of that. Mr. Emmanuel, I'll hand it to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Like where we stopped, you know, marketing plan is very important, and also the milestones you've achieved in your creative day or business. Now we'll talk about milestones. Now don't let me limit this to the entrepreneur. An example I've been using, what are those things you've done? For example, okay, let me still use, you know, okay, with my product, I've been able to educate Africans on why they need to patronize Africans. I have been able to, you know, that's one, two, with the awareness, more Africans are now where they are home in the diaspora. That's a milestone, you know. Another milestone is financial, and it's probably with my products, because I've been able to sell in the diaspora. I've been able to make, let's say, $5,000 revenue. That's a milestone. So, your financial profit is the milestone. Those things that brings glory to the business are milestones. By educating people about the African way is a milestone. Like you've been able to, you know, influence, let's say, 50 people about, you know, those things. These are milestones. So, have you generated a revenue for the last 1 year? Now, when we talk about revenue, revenue is simple. Revenue simply means all the money you generated, like minus expenses. When you now all the monies you generated, including expenses. For example, I invested 2 million naira in the business, and I've made 3 million naira in the business. You see that 3 million naira without subtracting the expenditure is the revenue. When you now subtract the expenditure from the revenue, that's where you get profit. And one of these days, we are going to do a session on financial literacy as a business person. So how much have you generated in the last 1 year? You need to keep your record. You need to keep books. They are called financial books as a business person. How much have you made in the past 1 year? You are going to put this, and you've not made anything. Please don't force it. Don't window it. Just put it there that you've not made anything. How many jobs do you create in 1 year? Now, for example, tell them the numbers. See, like we said, in the next 1 year, for Centric, where we'll be able to generate, say, to create employment opportunity for 20 young Nigerians, young Africans, to be specific, how do you see your, what do you see, where do you see your business in the next 5 years? This is the question, the vision, probably move from selling to Africans to, you know, this is more about your projection. Probably in the next 5 years, we'll not just do African wear alone, we'll do them in batches, we can sell in batches, we sell to every part of the world, even Asia. So we are not just influencing Africans now, we are also influencing the Western world to imbibe the African culture. I don't know if that is possible, but I'm saying from a standpoint of fashionpreneur, that okay, this is what we want to achieve. This would include your financial projection. Probably in the next 5 years, we are looking at making 100 million in revenue. So these are things you need to talk about. If you get to the final stage and you get the seed funding, what will you use the money for? Please don't say you use the money for CEO down this. So now this is where your strategic thinking comes in. What are you going to use the money for? I'm going to use the money to design a branded logo for my business. I'm going to use to buy machinery that will make my work easier. I'm going to create a website. So what are those things you're going to be using the money for? You need to itemize these things. Also, the next question is, where do you see, I've said that, the answer, if you get it, we said that, okay, you need to tell them if you apply for the grant or not before this next application for review. And ask your question after the session anyways. Okay, focus there. So here they said bankable calls who are from the university system. See, let me reiterate this, guys. Please, I know it's not easy writing them and attending U-coHub. See, whatever U-coHub is giving you now, U-coHub is handing over to you life and destiny. Right? U-coHub is, see, I wish all these things that U-coHub is doing, I had access to them when I was in the university, right? And life would have been like taking a quantum leap. But you guys are getting this on platter of gold. Please take note of it. See, this innovation is for university students, right? And the difference between the rich and the poor is information. You are getting this information live and direct at U-coHub. So you need to take this thing serious. So they said, this challenge shall recognize top 20 innovators from across the country and top 3 winners shall get the cash prize, right? So you need money for your business. So let's just get to where we review this application. Okay, please calm down. Thank you. Calm down. Okay, right. Describe your idea. Like I said, you must be a smart person when you're describing your idea. See, let me say this thing in Pidgin. In every African, there is an approach spirit, right? In every African, there's an approach spirit. So when you're describing what your idea is, tell the underlying brand story, the story behind the idea. Important. The story behind the idea. This is very, very important. So when you tell the story behind the idea, then you cannot talk about the solution, the problem. So you need to describe your idea by being, you know, telling your brand story. When you're telling your brand story, then the systems in which you are so the idea came about, then what challenge does it address? Now let me slide. Let me say I am writing this like someone playing in that cultural sector. Now, what challenge does it address? Now, let's for example with my innovation. I am creating, currently I grow plantain chips, right? Under that, there's food wastage in the rural area in Nigeria. And the problem is because as a result of lack of storage facility. Now, and I decided to do what? I am going to be doing a processing plant where we process cassava into gari or plantain chips, right? So, challenge addresses food wastage in rural community. So be specific for your challenge, or what your solution, or the solution you are providing, the solution. See, so the challenge is that There's a lot of food wastage in rural community, and I intend to solve this by creating a processing plant that reduces food wastage. So it's the solution is addressing food wastage in rural community. Then why do you want to take part in this challenge? Now, if I'm to answer this question, the first reason I want to take part in this challenge is because I've read about this challenge, and it's going to be a platform for me to learn to meet people, one, to learn about business, then three, whatever funding I'm getting from a challenge is going to give my business life. Now, if I'm still at the ideal stage, it means from the morning the funding is getting from this application can be able to now fund my idea. Please note that whenever I had, this is the last shot I'm giving in this, which is when you are describing your idea, always find a way, when you are telling your business story, what actually necessitated the solution you are solving, please always attach it to an SDG goal. If you are not telling, you are going to make sure you are using data. Please, when you are quoting any data, make sure you're giving a reference. It is important. Anytime you are quoting any data, either from World Bank, from UNESCO, make sure you are quoting your reference. Then, lastly, make sure you attach an SDG to whatever solution you are solving. Attach an SDG to whatever solution you are bringing to the table. You are attaching an SDG because they take you serious, and because they will find you that you are also solving the world problem. So if there's any question, please do let us know. Thank you for listening to me, and thank you for this opportunity.
Wow. That was a beautiful session by Mr. Emmanuel Tobilova. Thank you so much. So what I would like us to do is to go to the comment section, and right on your screen, you're going to see a little message icon on the lower part of your screen, right? Just click on it and tell me your questions if you have questions for Mr. Tobilova. I'm going to be pulling on my co-anchor, Ms. Sheila, to take the rest of our giveaway. She still has a left before we move quickly to the Q&A session. So, Ms. Sheila.
Good evening, everyone. Wonderful session, Mr. Toby. I hope everyone has been following, and I have definitely a lot from the session. I have Ethel. How do you signify after I read the numbers? Signify in the chat below.
I'm sorry, Miss Sheila. I would love you to take the card numbers slowly and repeat it twice. I think that some of us are not really getting it. So if you take it twice, maybe that might help us. Thank you.
Okay. Starting now with Ethel. 1165 1164 436. So that's Ethel, 1165 1864 436 6028. Thank you.
Can you all hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Loud and clear.
Yes, we can, please.
Yeah, I think Sheila is having a network issue. Okay, she's back.
I'm back now.
Please, if you can put the card on the chat button, I don't know, nobody signify he or she got the card.
Oh, okay. All right, I'll do that instead.
All right. So Ms. Sheila, are we done with session now? Can we move?
Yes, we can move on. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. So Mr. Toby Loba is available for Q&A sessions. If there is any one of us that has a question or two regarding what we are talking about this evening, kindly put your question in the message box or unmute your mic and speak up. So I'm going to be turning off my mic now and giving us the next 1 minute to signify if I have a question or two. Thank you. Okay, it seems like we all got it so well tonight that we don't have any questions. So I'm going to be moving quickly to the next item on the table. The next item on the table would be a few words from Mr. Jai David is going to be addressing us regarding a U-coHub activity, which is very important that we engage in. So, Mr. Jai David, can we take over the microphone? Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Good to see you again. I believe after this session, everyone should go on to that application and field. If you have any challenges, reach out to us. If you guys any question or any at any point you got stuck. Next week we'll be bringing on board a green entrepreneur. Green entrepreneur is you can call it agricultural person. Actually, is doing very well in that line. Green means agriculture, but he is not really farming, but actually is farming. But you get to know about what is green entrepreneur or green agriculture. Is working around climate change, and this is a global challenge where we are facing. And if you're able to solve any problem in that area, you are good to go. They are looking for you. Climate change is a global challenge everywhere in the world, and every time they keep putting up application, do you have any idea on how to solve a climate change problem? Reach out, send your application, send your proposal, let's work with you. So this thing is real and it's there. It's a huge problem, and some people have been working on it. You can join them. It is very interesting. He will be telling you how you can convert your waste. Mr. Togulaba was saying waste everywhere. Even Lagos State, a whole lot of waste. In Ondo State, a whole lot of waste everywhere. They litter everywhere, food waste, plastic, can, and every other kind of waste. But these guys are leveraging on this waste to create wealth. So I think that is amazing. The same waste you are pulling off from your house, these guys will collect and they turn into wealth using a technology. So I won't mention, you get to know. This session will be very crucial next week Friday. So come and hear how you can turn your waste into wealth. Come and hear about green entrepreneur and invite others. After this session, we'll be expecting you to send in your application. Let us preview for you. We reviewed two applications today, and they are very simple. If you can follow the steps laid down by our facilitator tonight, I think you are good to go. These applications are ending soon. A reminder will be sent again as regards this application after this meeting. The two applications we review today, we will send it up again to the group. Ensure you grab this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. David. Thank you for that update. So I believe we all got that. And we are excited already. We're looking forward to that particular session. And, you know, U-coHub to make it an amazing one for you. I'd like to remind us that we have the recharge card numbers in the message box. So if you haven't gotten any one of them, I think you should go ahead and read the message box. You're going to find them all in there. Read them and let us know once you've gotten any one of them. Okay, so the stranger says, I and thanks a lot. Thank you too. Thanks for participating. And thank you for appreciating our little gift. So we're still expecting feedback from the rest of us. We still have Ethel in the box waiting for you to look at this. So don't waste time. Like they say, don't sleep on it. We are going to be moving now to the closing remark by Miss Wonwola Omotosho as we wrap up this evening's session. Miss Wonwola.
Yeah, well done. That was an amazing and cut to life. I was expecting, if they have no questions, Toby, I was expecting we give them one or two questions, right? But what do you think? I was actually expecting a large number of questions as regards this topic. I don't know why we didn't have.
Yes, I think you can go ahead with that. I think you can ask questions. The floor is open for you to ask questions.
Maybe you or Mr. Toby will have one or two questions to ask them. I think Mr. Toby should be in the best position.
I didn't get that part, Ms. Warner. What did you say?
I said you should be in the best position to ask them questions since we do not get any questions from them.
Okay.
As regards the train.
Okay, so I spoke about some essential, let me say, I call some things unwritten laws of grant writing. So who can tell us like one or two of those unwritten laws I mentioned? When I talked about grant writing, I said there are some unwritten laws you should follow if you want to write an impressive grant. So who can tell us the unwritten laws I mentioned? Those are written laws I mentioned. So this is the proof if we actually followed or we were at the point lost in the conversation. Put it in clear terms. Say, are those things you should consider if you want to write a winning grant? The office is quiet. Alright, let me do the favor of or the honor of reiterating those things I said again. First thing I said was that you should take storytelling very, very, very important. Storytelling is important. Two, I said you must look for mentors who would help you review your application. That this is very, very important. then I said you must always apply before, like you need to apply early enough that takes the prayer of, you know, you want to meet the deadline, you want to do this, you want to do that, away from you. So these were the things I said. Let's ask another question. What's the meaning of USP? What's the meaning of USP? Anybody, what is the meaning of USP?
Sorry, I want to answer something. Hello?
Yeah, I can hear you loud and clear.
I think it means unique, your unique selling point.
Awesome. Please, before you unmute, I know this is your daily like MedSearch, right?
Yes.
Okay, can you tell
sorry, me? Sorry, I was looking for the raise hand icon. I'm sorry.
Oh. No problem. Fine. So what is the USP of your own what is the USP of MedSearch?
MedSearch is basically the fact that the medical student, it's owned by the medical student generally. So that's the unique selling point.
Okay. I think after the session we need to talk and rephrase or work on that unique selling point. Mm-hmm. Or who else want to talk about their product, their innovation unique selling point? So that we get to know those unique selling points we need to work on. So the absence of none, or probably we'll continue the conversation in the mentorship group. We'd like to work with you on that. Like now we'll be working with Ayo daily on this. We need to work on that to make it more impressive. So thank you.
Thank you, sir. So we'd like to thank you all and congratulate you for being part of tonight's thrilling, interesting, educating, entertaining, and motivating session. You will agree with me. Yeah. Partners got me from tonight's training, the act of storytelling. And Toby said something that I will hold on to. He said, your story never fades. Yeah. And so Jesus, your story is your story. So please hold on to that. The aspect continually, man says, what is worth doing all is worth doing well. And I think I'm going to add this going on time. So please pay cognizance to applications, to proposals, big time. And it's something about knowledge economy. That's a new knowledge for me, and we're reading about Finland as a case study regards knowledge economy. So tonight is really amazing. We'd like to appreciate Mr. Toby and Mr. Jayu for doing this magic again tonight. And to our beautiful hosts, Olami and Sheila, that was amazing. And of course, to our audience, our mentees, thank you for the consistency, commitment, and the growth to learn, to relearn, and to be the best. Of course, tonight will not be complete if we don't share and give our best gratitude to our key partners, University of Medical Sciences in those states, the British Council, and of course, Liverpool John Monge University, United Kingdom. I am looking forward to hearing and seeing more about implementation of this training, reflecting in your years, reflecting in businesses. Please let's take note of how we do. Let it reflect in your years, let it reflect in your businesses. Chat up mentors, feel free to ask anytime. We are here for you. So on behalf of U-coHub, I can assure us all that we will never relent in playing our parts to ensure your ideas are globalized, to ensure your ideas get to the world. So I wish us all a fruitful weekend. Stay blessed. And thank you once again for being this tonight. God bless. Bye.
Thank you so much for that awesome closing remark. Thank you everyone for participating, and have a great night. See you all next week.
All right, thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Yes, I'm happy to be able to share in the groups.
after we're done with the session. Thank you.